Good morning. And the day of rejoicing has come, a day of celebration as we have come to worship our God who's so deserving of our praise. But to come into this place and to be close together as we're experiencing now the renewing of our sanctuary in these summer months. What a joy it is to be together. Thank you for adjusting your schedules and all that you've done to make this time together a time where we can come and worship the living God in this hour together. So we're going to lift our voices and give him praise for all that he's done. He's been faithful to us, mostly the gift of Jesus Christ for giving us his son. We're going to worship him because of Christ. All of this is possible. Let's stand together. Take your hymnal. It's hymn number 349. Lift your voices. We sing the first and the last stanzas. Join with me. To God. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. On the last, great things he had taught us, great things he had done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our God, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come, through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory. Great things he God's people said, amen. Be seated. And as you are, take your order of service. I thought it'd be wonderful as we have worshipers in the balcony and here on the main floor that we recite together this wonderful picture of worship when Isaiah went in and had the vision of God high and lifted up. I'm going to read the light text. Notice, balcony worshipers, you've got the next statement. Main floor worshipers, let's speak this scripture together and understand what it means to be in the presence of a worthy God. I'll begin. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. And one
called to
and the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. And he touched my mouth and said,
behold,
and I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then I said, here am I, send me. Stand together again. Lift your voice. Hymn number one. verse now without the instruments.
Holy,
let's pray together. Lord, you are holy. You're set apart. You are not like us. And we're reminded through our singing already together collectively, we are more sinful than we have ever imagined and yet more loved than we can ever know. And we thank you for the gospel. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the cross. We thank you that you've made it possible for us to worship you today and every day of our lives. We are so grateful to be here today. We are so thankful. Our hearts are stirred because we're reminded of how much you love us. So Lord, speak to us and we will proclaim our love for you. We set our hearts on you, our minds, everything that we are for this hour that you might change us. And we would leave this place differently because we came. We thank you for your presence among us now, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, Pastor. We cry, holy, holy. We fall down in reverence of him. Would you sing with me? We fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus, the greatness of mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy is the Lamb. From your heart to him, we fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus, the greatness of mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy.
Thank you, Stephen. I don't know about you, I have looked forward to today for a lot of reasons. To gather with the church family, but also to gather in the best singing room in this church. And I hope that you have been blessed as we've declared the very holiness of our God. We do want to welcome you to the first of our chapel Sundays as we go across the summer. This is going to be a wonderful summer for us. We're grateful that you're here to begin this series with us. If you happen to be here today as our guest, we are glad that you're with us at Park Cities, and you're going to find on the back of your bulletin a QR code. If you would, take just a moment, take your phone out. You can scan it. Let us know that you're here. If we might serve you, please give us a contact. We want to serve you in any way that you have a need, but we're glad that you're with us today. Well, you know, last Sunday was our last Sunday in the sanctuary for quite some time. In fact, for the next 2 months. We won't be back in there until September the 8th. That's our projection right now, and we've begun our sanctuary refresh. You may have noticed signs saying, please do not enter this construction area. And on Monday morning, if you're in the choir, you'll be glad to know the first thing that we tackled was the choir loft. And so when we come back in there and the building is fully complete, what you're going to see is a choir loft that is elevated. We are going to hear like we've never heard before. We're going to worship like we've never worshiped before. And we're going to be in a totally refreshed building. But it takes all of us during these couple of months to sacrifice a little bit. How many of you, your Connect group changed to accommodate this change right now? Look at this. Thank you. That's what I'm talking about. So we are working hard. So would you pray? Would you pray for the safety of all those that are engaged? It is a construction zone. Pray for all the decisions that still have yet to be made and for all that's before us. Pray about maybe your part in financing this, but a lot of things that are happening in there, and we are grateful to God. And again, by Thanksgiving, we're trusting that it is all complete, or I may not have a job. So we're trusting then again that by Thanksgiving, this is all done. Now, you may have also noticed on the back of your bulletin how we finished up our financial year. And what you'll see is we exceeded our giving requirements. And that, again, is the generosity of God's people. As the Lord spoke into hearts, people responded. And because of that, we have lots of ministries that are happening. Right now, you can pray for our students. They're at The Camp in beautiful northern New Mexico. They're at Glorieta. I imagine it is a little bit cooler there today than it's going to be here. So pray for our kids as they're out and they're in worship and in Bible study and they're having a great time together. Pray for safety for them across the week. We have trips that are headed down to the Caribbean Basin. We have more trips this summer down to the border area. We have a great parenting conference coming up, really for the city, at the end of August. And all of it happens, every one of these, because people give of themselves. That's generosity. We have adult sponsors that are working with our teams this week. Right now, we have adults that are caring for your children and your grandchildren. And again, financially, all of us are coming together to help us do all of these ministries. And it's a glory to God. So today as we give of ourselves to His glory so that His word might go forth. Would you join me as we pray? Father, would you take all that's happening here, all that's happening here, may it not be about us, may it be about declaring your great grace and your worth. And Father, we thank you. Help us not to take for granted all that's happening in these days. How many churches would love to be in a position like we are? But that puts a heavy requirement on us. May we be faithful. So Lord, we pray that you'd bless our worship this morning. Again, to your great glory, in Jesus' name, amen. Now right now, would you turn around and stand up, greet those around you.
Thank you, Ronnie.
Let's stand together.
My faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is no
love with no end. Come. darkest night. Let your love come over us. Let your light shine on us.
Wow. Thank you, Bill, Brian, Stephen. Gosh, you sound great today. Rodney, you know that this is the best singing room in the house, on campus. So good to see you. I want us to pray together as we open God's word. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me? Just lay your life before the Lord right now. Just say, Lord, speak to me. You pray. Lord, speak to me. Lord, we come collectively together with all of our individual challenges and grief and pain and struggles and joys. And we ask now that you will do what I cannot do. I pray that you will speak into every heart. Help me to get out of the way and let your Spirit lead the way through your word. And may you touch every heart here today. And I pray, God, that you will speak. We are your children. We are listening. So, Father, Spirit, speak to us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. It's so good to see you today. So this week, I hope you had a great 4th of July. We thought this weekend is probably the weekend. Lots of folks out, but you've showed up in mass. And thank you again for those of you who've moved your connect groups around to make this happen. We thought, with the good work of Keith Lowry, among others on our team, we think we've got it, but we're going to be filling this place up. So come early, make room, let's squeeze in and all those good things. So it's great to see you today. So for a minute, this week, 4th of July is always awesome because our entire country really, I think, rises above all of the craziness and the polarization or division within our country, and we aspire to greater things. We celebrate our freedom. I know in Washington, D.C., New York City, here in Dallas, in your family perhaps, you have been celebrating. I hope it's been a great 4th of July weekend. But you know, when I travel around the world, some of you have done this, all over the world, people see there's a different spirit in America, and it's true. Even friends in the UK, they'll say, man, you guys have this entrepreneurial kind of can-do spirit that you don't see anywhere else. And people are drawn to that. I think here in Dallas, like it's in spades, you know, here in Dallas. We can do anything, right? And of course, that can get us into trouble sometimes, but for the most part, it is an amazing thing. And it's why America is so great. And all of this comes back to, I think, this revolutionary spirit that we have. And a celebration of freedom. Like we're free to do what, you know, whatever we're called to do. Now we have a dark side of our history as well, like we all do personally as well. Darker moments that define us. I think of our country's original sin of slavery. Of racism. And a lot of us, we look back on a checkered past, even in our own families, in our own lives, and we think, man, let's just move on. Some of us are like, let's just get on. Why can't we get past the past? Let's just move on. Let's get on with it. And really, you can't really do that, can you? I mean, therapist offices, pastors' offices are filled with people who are trying to get past the past, who are stuck in the past. For various reasons. Family, marriage counselors. We'll talk about your family of origin, how it impacts your life. And we all need to move past the past. So today we're going to talk about getting stuck in the past. This will, frankly, be a rather tender sermon for a lot of us. And I pray that the Lord, the Spirit will do in you, start a work in you as he speaks to your heart. That you too, all of us, get past the past. Whatever that might be for you. If you've been here or you know the story of Joseph at all, he has a traumatic past. Here's a man who grew up with a passive father who set his brothers up against him. He ultimately ends up in a place where he never dreamed to be. He's trafficked into slavery, ends up in a foreign land. He even gets accused of doing something he didn't do. I mean, what trauma has this man been through? He ends up in prison, and yet through it all, the Lord raises him up. You can turn to chapter 42 is where we'll be in your Bible. You're going to need to walk through this chapter with me. We're going to draw from it. This passage is amazing. This story is incredible. Chapter 42 of Genesis. Yeah, that's where we are. And now in chapter 41, we see that he's risen up. We know this. If you know the story, he's called governor. He's like a prime minister. He's running this Operation Famine is what he's doing now as we pick up on the story. He's had two sons. Watch how this reveals a bit of how he's trying to process out of his past. Manasseh, which means God has made me forget. It really means to forget, but he qualifies it. Forget all my hardship and all the trouble of my father's house. And then he has another son, Ephraim, that means for God, it means fruitful. And he says, for God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction. I mean, wow. You're like, okay, he's dealt with his past. It looks like he's dealt with it. Now, some of us here today, you've dealt with your past, I hope. A lot that you've walked through, whether it be suffering and trauma of your past, still working through that. Perhaps it's regret and shame we look back to the past. A lot of us have that. Maybe it's, for some of us, it's a nostalgia. It's a idolizing of the past. That'll stick. That'll keep you stuck in the past. We see all three of these in this story. And what we're going to see is we can work through our past until yet again it comes back to haunt us. And Joseph is literally going to see his past face to face with him in this passage. If you know the story, you'll know where this is heading. We have three case studies here, really interesting, in this chapter 42. I'm going to break it down this way. We see Joseph's suffering. We see the brother's regret. And we see Jacob's nostalgia. I'm going to call it nostalgia, but a twisted kind of an idolization of the past. So three things we're going to see. Suffering can keep you stuck in the past. I'm going to call it suffering. Trauma, what we have gone through in the past. Those are things that have been done to us. Okay, we all have that. And then we have regret can keep us stuck in the past. Is the second thing we'll see here. And this is, we see this with the brothers. Everybody's stuck in this story, by the way. We see Jacob is stuck because of nostalgia. Nostalgia can keep you stuck in the past. So if you take notes on sermons, this one is a deep dive. And I want you to process this with me. Think through this with me. And I'm just trusting the Spirit's going to move as I prayed earlier with others just to say things I can't say or don't have time to say. First, let's look at this. Suffering can keep us stuck in the past. Your suffering, your trauma, your grief. These are things, again, that have happened to you. Maybe someone else has made decisions that have impacted you, or maybe these things have just happened. Many of us have lost loved ones, or relationships are broken. These are things that have happened to you. Look at verse 1, chapter 42. When Jacob learned that there was grain for sale in Egypt, he said to his sons, why are you looking at each other? Why are you sitting around looking at each other? Go, and he says, I've heard there's grain in Egypt for sale. So go down and buy grain for us there and come back so that we can live and not die, all right? Now, if there's a famine in Egypt, I took a little deep dive here in the rabbit trails I run through in study, but took a deep dive into it. If there's a famine in Egypt, there's a major famine in Canaan. You might know that Egypt is fed, you would assume, fed by the Nile River. You might not know the Nile runs north. It flows north into the Mediterranean Sea from, anybody know? Lake Victoria, 4,100 miles away. Longest river in the world. And so if there's not rain in certain parts of, gosh, all over Africa, that's way down in Uganda, Tanzania, Kenya, if you've ever been to that area of the world, this river runs. And if there's no water in the delta, then the whole region is struggling. And it still happens. And particularly with population boom in Egypt and such, 90% of all water in Egypt comes from the Nile. And they still struggle through famines over and over again. And this is what's happening here. But all that to say, Jacob and the sons, they're in big trouble. And so he's saying, we've got to do something or we're going to die. Verse 3, so the 10 of the brothers went down to buy grain in Egypt. But Jacob did not send Benjamin, Joseph's brother, all right, with his brothers. This comes into play. For he feared that harm might happen to him. Because the last time, right, he released Joseph, his favorite son, he didn't make it home. So he says, okay, he's kind of, this is another dagger into the hearts of these boys. Well, now men. This is some 21 years later, by the way. And so they're grown men sitting around. Why don't you go get some grain for us or we die? But this dagger is, hey, I don't know. I don't care what happens to you guys, but don't take Benjamin. He's my guy. Why is he so special? Why was Joseph and Benjamin so special to him? Anybody know? Rachel. His favorite wife. He cannot release Benjamin. That'd be the last connection that he has to Rachel. So look at verse 5. Thus the sons of Israel came to buy among the others who came, for the famine was in the land of Canaan. Now Joseph was governor over the land. Here it is. He was the one who sold to all the people of the land. And a lot of narrative here. Again, Operation Famine he's been running. He's got granaries all over Egypt now. And he's, you know, the people are being cared for. So people are coming from all over. And Joseph's brothers came and bowed themselves before him with their faces to the ground. Does this remind you of anything? This was his dream. That's right. When he was 17 years old. 21 years later, he's 38 years old. All the brothers are older than him, except for Benjamin, who's going to be back home. Now, they don't recognize him. They don't recognize. Now, in part, we assume he had a shaved head. I mean, he's looking fly. He looks really good. But he also has Egyptian garb on. And he's speaking Egyptian, we know, note later. There's a translator here. They would not expect, and he's grown up quite a bit. Now, he knows who this motley crew is. He knows them, and he sees them right away. Can you imagine what he's going through right now? To see them. Out of nowhere, they show up. But he treated them like strangers and spoke roughly to them. So initially, he's not, no. Not you guys. Where do you come from? He said. They said, from the land of Canaan to buy food. And Joseph recognized his brothers, but they did not recognize him. And Joseph, okay, remembered the dreams that he had dreamed of them. And he said to them, you're spies. You have come to see the nakedness of the land. Now, this would have been, it made sense that others are coming in to see Egypt's weakness now, to see what's happening here, but also to get food. And they said to him, no, my Lord, your servants have come to buy food. We are all sons of one man. We are honest men. Your servants have never been spies. You can hear Joseph thinking, honest men. Still liars, I know that much. But he's confronted with his past in multiple ways. This is a fascinating story. He said to them, no, it is the nakedness of the land that you've come to see. You've come to see our weakness. And they said to him, listen, we're your servants. We're 12 brothers, sons of one man. The youngest is with him still this day, but one is no more. Wow. But Joseph said to them, you know, it's as I said to you, you're spies. By this you shall be tested. By the life of Pharaoh, this is a common swearing of an oath to the king, as it were. You shall not go from this place unless your youngest brother comes here. Now Joseph is thinking on his feet here. Send one of you and let him bring your brother while you remain confined, that your words may be tested whether there is truth in you. Or else, by the life of Pharaoh, surely you're spies. And he put them all together in custody for 3 days. He threw them in jail for 3 days. Now, think about this. The questions that come to play. And if you've never read this story, really interesting. We're looking at episode all summer long. This is what's cool. This is a summer blockbuster. We're looking at just one episode after another. And we're seeing here, is he intimidating them? Is he angry right away? It seems he speaks roughly to them. Is he testing them? Is he trying to sort out whether he can trust them? Is he trying to figure out what to do in the moment? I think it's all of that. All of the emotions are there. Verse 18, on the third day, Joseph said to them, do this and you will live, for I fear God. If you are honest men, let one of your brothers, now he changes the direction. He's got a plan, but he changes it a bit. Let one of your brothers remain confined where you are in custody right here. And let the rest of you go carry grain for the famine to your households and bring the youngest son, the youngest brother, back to me. So your words would be verified and you shall not die. And they did so. Now this story is so interesting because you can't quite figure out the motivations of those involved. Like, wait, what are they doing? What's Joseph? What is he doing? What's he thinking? And this is masterful writing. Of course, it's the word of God. Have the brothers changed? We don't know. Is Joseph trying to, can he trust them again? Does he want to trust them again? What has happened to his full-blooded brother? We know. He doesn't know. Is he gone after Joseph's gone? Is something happened to him? Murderers, traffickers, liars are standing in front of him, and he holds their fate in his hands. This is high drama. This is amazing. How is it that we don't really know exactly what's going on? Here it is. We're being drawn into the process. What would you do? How would you respond? Would you seek revenge? Will Joseph be defined by his trauma? Will you be? See, we're drawn in. This is the word of God. This is why this is such a unique book. I'm about to say a powerful story. There's nothing like the Bible. We enter in to read the Bible. It reads us. And so what's happening here with all of us, keep tracking, let the Spirit lead you. We for far too long, many of us have been stuck in the past of things that have been done to us, things that have happened to us, things that maybe, again, it's grief, it's loss. Our tests come in the form of denial. It comes in the form of maybe harder work. It comes in the form of trying to justify ourselves and validate our existence. I'll show you that I've overcome. And we all know people like that who seem to be just high strung, and we wonder, what is going on here? Because we don't know their past story. We don't know how they're dealing with such trauma. And then so many of us, we enter into diversions of how we deal with the past. The more resource you have, the more you do that. Some of us drink too much. Some of us buy too much. We eat too much. We go into all kinds of diversion, trying to medicate our pain. And some of that leads to addiction. Until it's dealt with, we wear labels, don't we, that define us. And we all do. This is really fascinating to sit with a therapist or someone that could help us understand this. We have soundtrack kind of loops that play in our minds. Some of us, I'm the victim. That's who I am. I'm a victim. I'll never trust anybody again. And it plays out in your relationships. Some of us, I'm forgotten. That's who I am. I'm the rejected one. I'm not smart enough. I'm not good looking enough. I'm unloved. That's who I am. We play out these identities. We start to live out these storylines. What is it for you? Let the Spirit speak into your heart. See, sometimes our suffering, our past trauma and loss can keep us stuck in the past. And what we often do too is we blame others, don't we? They may be long gone. We're still blaming them. And blame, the problem with blame is, we'll say, they did this thing to me. I'm a victim. And I can't change that because it's already happened and they've done it. It wasn't me. There's no way out of that. You're stuck. Blame leads to shame. Shame doesn't just say, I've done something wrong or things have happened to me. Shame says, I am wrong and I cannot change. And some of us are living there today. In my great prayers that you be set free, shame runs so much deeper. Let me ask you this. If we don't overcome our trauma, if we don't talk through it, if we don't deal with it, we're going to stay stuck in the past. Why is it that so many who've been abused become abusers themselves? Why is it that so many of us who saw the effects of addiction become addicts ourselves? Why is it that so many of us who saw brokenness in our family are the ones who repeat it all together, all over again? because we're stuck and we never deal with our trauma. Hang with me. The brothers are stuck in the past because of the traumatic events that they've gone through. Joseph's past is horrible. He's stuck in the past. The only way for them to move forward, and you can apply this as you will, is for them to trust one another again. In terms of relationships, that's the only way forward. Here's the key. One little phrase. Did you catch it? One little phrase, verse 18. Go back to it. Do this and you'll live, because I fear God. I'm trusting God with this. Have you trusted God with all the trauma of your past and whatever you're going through, whatever you're sorting through, to the degree that you can establish trust with others, you can move forward. Now, some of you are thinking, perhaps, well, I can't. That person's not around anymore. Or they don't want to be reconciled. That person that did me wrong, they're gone. This is where we have to step back and let the grace of God, his love for us, define us. And say, Lord, I'm going to embrace the grace that I live in. I live in a broken world. I'm broken. I have a broken past. We all do. I'm going to be defined by you. See, the relationship between Joseph and his brothers is frozen. It's stuck. And what he's doing, though, he does have a plan. First, he was imprisoning all of them. Then he imprisons Simeon. He wants to, look at this, brilliant. He's got 3 days to think through this. If Benjamin can come back and he's alive, he's good. If he can vouch for them that he's happy, well-adjusted, then Joseph's going to go, these guys have changed. Or he would not be where he is. So he is now saying, listen, I got a plan. Let me ask you, do you have a plan to get unstuck from your past? Are you thinking, well, time heals all wounds? No, it does not. We say it around here. Time can heal some things, but here's what the Spirit heals, not time. Time can make you bitter, not better. But the Spirit can work in us, and it's about sharing and walking through this. Let's keep rolling. We're going to unpack this a bit more. The second thing we see here is regret can keep us in the past. Now, these are things that we have done, and we all have these. Verse 21, then they said to one another, in truth, we are guilty concerning our brother in that we saw the distress of his soul when he begged us and we did not listen. Now, why are they bringing this up? That is why this distress has come upon us. Ah, and Reuben, who starts to become kind of a leader here among them, an older brother, answered them, did I not tell you not to sin against the boy, but you did not listen? So now there comes a reckoning for his blood. You see what they're doing? We've sinned. We sinned. That's why we're going through this. He's partly right. We all know when there is sin, there's got to be some kind of payment for it. But this is karma. This is not the gospel. And some of us are living that way. We're not living defined by the gospel, by being in Christ. Instead, here's what we do. I deserve to be punished. And that plays out in all kinds of ways, right? I'll pay for my sin. That's one way. I'll pay penance for my sin. That's what I'll do. And I'll feel really rotten about this thing I've done. And the more rotten I feel, and the longer I feel horrible about it, the more I'll pay for it. And some of us have not fully embraced the grace of God, and we still live in that. We have not released the past, and we're stuck. I deserve to be punished. I'll pay for my sin. And this plays out in a lot of different ways as well. For some of us, it's I'm not worthy of much more. We start to some literally punish. I'll punish my body in some form. Some of us enter to a self-salvation program. I've seen it in homes where there's addiction, there's trouble in a home, and one child generally will rise up as the hero. I will prove that my family's not jacked up. I will prove that we're normal, and I'll be the face of it. And that's where some of us can run. But we want to pay the price for sin, and that's what's happening here. We need to embrace the grace of God. Look at verse 23. They did not know that Joseph understood them. Wow, how about this? For there was an interpreter between them. Then he turned away from them and wept. Again, wait, why? What's going on here? Is this PTSD? Is this trauma too much for him? Because they're talking through the whole thing. Is it that maybe he's seeing there's a little bit of remorse at least? What's happening? Let's keep rolling. It says he returned to them and spoke to them, and he took Simeon from them and bound him before their eyes. Pulls Simeon out, binds him right there in front of them. And then, verse 25, Joseph gave orders to fill their bags with grain, replace every man's money in the sack, and give provisions so they'd have provisions for the journey. This was done for them. They loaded their donkeys and grain, departed, and one of them opened a sack when they came to a lodging spot, and he found the money there. In verse 28, my money's been put back. And then look at this, and their hearts sank. Like their hearts failed. They were terrified. Whoa, what? Why? They're thinking, wait, this is not my money. They're gonna think we took money. What is happening? And then even here, what is God doing to us? You see, our sin from the past can cause us to not only have regrets in the present, but it can cause us to fear God and to walk in shame and guilt. I have a good friend who is who's a psychologist, and I talked to him about this passage. And he said he wrote this to me. There's an important psychological and spiritual principle here. When we do not bring our pain into the safety and security of relationship where we can receive comfort and process our pain and resolve our pain, it invariably becomes bitterness and resentment, even fear. And then has a significantly destructive potential for people around us. Joseph turns away in verse 24. He's early in the process, but he turns away. Instead, we should turn in. Somebody needs to hear this today. We need to turn, especially with siblings, with family and close friends, even in our pain, we need to turn to others. The way out, watch this, is to recognize what we've done. The way out is not regret. Regret's the start. The way out is repentance. It's repentance. I will never do this thing again. You must move past regret into repentance. That's how we find freedom. And then friends, listen, somebody needs to hear this today. If you've done that, you have repented of your sin, you've confessed it before the Lord, you have received his grace, move on. Move on. Some of us are living in the past and we need to move on in the freedom that we have in Christ. To cling to it is not to embrace the full grace that's come your way. And then what happens here? Okay, suffering, regret. And then I want to see this last piece. They come back, they tell Jacob what's happened in verses 29 through 34. And I want you to see here as we close this, I'm going to call it nostalgia. It can be a good thing. But I'm saying this twisted nostalgia of an idolized past. Nostalgia can keep us stuck in the past. So what happens in verse 35 there, they empty their sacks. They find that they have money in their sack and they're all afraid. And Jacob says, you have bereaved me of my children. Joseph is no more. Simeon is no more. And now you would take Benjamin. They've already said, we're going to take Benjamin back with us. All this has come against me. And then Reuben said to him, kill my two sons. If I do not bring him back to you, put him in my hands and I will bring him back to you. But he said, Jacob said, my son shall not go with you, for his brother's dead. And he's the only one left. Again, dagger to the hearts of these men. He's the only one? If harm should come to him, should happen to him on this journey that you are to make, you would bring down my gray hairs with sorrow to Sheol. You'd take me down. What's going on here? So you know Joseph, we said earlier, Benjamin, are the only boys from Rachel. He's idolized Rachel from the start. And I think in a very unhealthy way. He can't let go of the last connection that he has with her, even to save the life of another son. He won't do it. He's idolizing the past. But think about this. No one is nostalgic about the past if it was horrible, right? Is Joseph? Is he idolizing his past? I don't think so. And many of us, we look back and we think, man, I was so smart, I was so strong, I was all that. No, you weren't. Many of us have a revisionist history of the past. but by the grace of God. So no one is overly nostalgic about the past. Well, listen to this. If your present is amazing. And what I think we need to learn here is this. See, God wants us to release the past. The past is gone. Some of us need to hear this. It is gone. And you will never be able, watch this, to move into the future, even better, live in the present if you hang on to the past. How would you know you're hanging on to an unhealthy, you know, clinging to the past? You live in the past in your mind. How about this? You cannot change. You will not change. Some of us get so rigid in the present, we just cling to the past. Our strategies, our forms, our preferences, they're all in the past. Instead of doing what God is doing among us now and embracing the present, we must sacrifice our future in order to live in the present. Watch this. Here's the solution, all right? Hang with me. Reuben, of all people, offers the solution. Did you catch it? It's sacrifice. So wait, how? He offers the sacrifice of his future. Think about this. If he has no sons, he has no future. He's willing to sacrifice his future. Listen, to move forward, you must also sacrifice the thought of what you've made your future out to be. We have to embrace the present. Reuben understands it's only sacrifice. He's right about this. Watch this. It is life for life. But even it seems Jacob knows that Reuben's sacrifice of his sons is not going to get it done. The death of Reuben's sons is inadequate to fix the problem. The death of his sons are not going to free captive Simeon. The death of his sons aren't going to feed the people in Canaan. The death of his sons aren't going to bring back a lost son, the lost Joseph, bring his wife back from the dead. His offer is wonderful, but it's inadequate. And we know that our sacrifices, whatever we may offer to God, is not enough and will never give us the future we want. We know this. This is called maturity. Maturity is recognizing you are fatally incapable of fixing your past or your future. So where does that leave us? What Jacob, the father, knows, his son cannot give. God, our Father, knows what his son can give to us. He gives us a future. It is life for life. The death of Jesus can set captives free. The death of Jesus can feed those who are living without purpose, starving for purpose in their lives. The death of Jesus can bring the lost home. The death of Jesus can bring the dead back to life. And he's calling us to him today, because only in Christ he offers you a future by declaring your past null and void, finished. And some of us need to embrace his grace more than we ever have today. See, God has done all that is necessary for us to be set free. But we've got to sacrifice our vision of the future. We need to let go of the past so that we can embrace the present. I've said this before. A good friend of mine who's an addict who's seeking to overcome all things of his past trauma to live into the future, he says this: when I go back into the past, all I have is regret and shame. I'm going to go there without God. Now, there's faithfulness and all the glory of God in the past. But then he says, and if I go into the future, all I have is worry and anxiety. Friends, listen. God has called you to live in the present. Right now. And the only way you can do that is to give your life to the one who sacrificed everything for you. It's the only way forward. It's the only way we find grace. So I want us to close our time together by praying together. Here as Americans, we collectively have celebrated higher aspirations of freedom and the joy we have. We have a checkered past, but listen, we as God's people, the church, we celebrate the fact that we've been completely forgiven. We are not defined by our past. We're defined by Jesus' past. His past is perfect. He has set us free so we can live forgiven, and we can live not worrying about the future, not glorying in the past or with regret and shame. We can live in the present and be fully present to worship him right now. And later today at 2 o'clock, and tomorrow at 4 o'clock, Tuesday morning when we wake up, live in the present. That's what he's calling you to. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you that you have spoken to us by your word today. We thank you for this glorious story. So much to unpack here. I pray, Lord, that each of my brothers and sisters here, having heard from you, will now speak and process and think through what you have said to us today. Maybe it starts at lunch. Maybe it starts in a connect group. Maybe it starts with a friend. Lord, help us to do the hard work of releasing the past by simply giving our lives to you. You have set us free, and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen. Hey, I want to also thank all of our Connect Group leaders and those of you who changed times. It's a shift, a missional move for you, and we're grateful. And it's going to get even more so. The need for us to come early, move in, make sure that everybody has a spot. We've got a quick turnaround, too. That'll be unique in this service especially. We have a quick turnaround. There's people in the back. Perhaps you heard them as I did. I was focused. But we're learning on this first Sunday how we're going to do this. It's going to be glorious and wonderful. So let me encourage you, if you're physically able to head out that way, it would help. We think most people are actually coming this way because they're coming from connect groups and such. Now, we do have an elevator right back here if you need it, stairs and such that way too. But yeah, let's help in terms of traffic. Let's all stand together. Let's keep praying for our students. Let's be back next week. Invite friends to come and join you, okay? I'll be here at the front along with others. We would love for you to come today. Maybe you have received Christ and you understand the need for forgiveness. Maybe you want to come join the church. Come be baptized. Come talk to us. If you have questions, I'll be here at the front with Rodney and others, okay? So let's pray together. Lord, thank you for this day, the beauty of it. We now go into it to worship you, embracing the present, to be fully present, to love others as you have loved us. We thank you for Jesus who has set us free. In his name we pray. Amen. All right, y'all, have a great day. Have a great week.